Hey, so the video's late, I know. It's a late video, and I'm going to tell you exactly why that is. It's because this month, streaming services released 19 movies in a 30-day span. And on top of that, I'm also a full-time student taking multiple cinema studies classes, for which I have to watch at least 2 movies a week. I'm also the host of a podcast, the No Nerds Allowed podcast. And I gotta watch a movie every week for that, too. So, between those 3 obligations, I watched upwards of 40 films in the last 40 days. So it's taken me a second to get around to this, alright? My bad, okay? And I know, boo-hoo, poor baby, he had to watch a lot of movies, but fucking you try it, okay? It takes a lot of energy out of a person to watch 40 movies. In 40 days. That's not even counting the ones I watched just because I wanted to, because I'm a crazy person. Okay? October was crazy because everybody wanted their slice of the COVID Halloween pie, and that means that there were 10 discrete horror movies beamed into houses across America within the span of 14 days of each other, including 4 Blumhouse horror movies released on Amazon Prime within 7 days of each other, alright? It's this new project they're doing called Welcome to the Blumhouse, which means that I had to sit down and watch 4 horror movies in one sitting. And aside from the 10 horror movies, there was also this glut of, like, surprise movies that just dropped with basically no forewarning, including a sequel to Borat and a new Robert Zemeckis movie. So I don't know what that's all about. So it was just a big month, okay? And I'm sorry about it, but I'm gonna stop whining now, because I'm here and I'm doing this for you, okay? And I will also say that as of right now, barring any surprises, only 8 movies on the docket for November. So hopefully I'll be able to catch up and get my schedule back together. For now, shit's whack, okay? I'm going to start with the Halloween horror movies, okay? Because there were so many of them, and so few of them were any good, I'm just gonna rapid fire. I'm just gonna go through this shit as quick as I can right now. And it's mostly just because I don't want this video to be 4 hours long, okay? I could have made this video 4 hours long, but I didn't, and you guys should be grateful to me for that. First of all, Amazon. Welcome to the Blumhouse. Oh, that wasn't actually first of all. Vampires versus the Bronx on Netflix. What if gentrification was vampires? This movie posits. And also, what if gentrification was vampires and the vampires were boring? Neither funny, nor exciting, nor thought-provoking, functionally pointless. No meaningful reason to watch Vampires versus the Bronx. I don't care who you are. The only thing I liked about it was that they talked about Blade a whole bunch. That's pretty funny. The kids call the vampires suckheads. That's kind of a good joke. Give it a 3 out of 10. Hubie Halloween is one of those Adam Sandler Netflix movies. And if you thought maybe he was gonna clean up his act after Uncut Gems, you were sorely mistaken. Because this is exactly the same shit that you would expect this to be. I don't know, Tim Meadows and Maya Rudolph are pretty funny in it. But that's pretty much all it's got going for it. Seems like he had fun with his friends. 4 out of 10. Black Box. This is the first Amazon Blumhouse Welcome to the Blumhouse movie. And honestly, I think it's my favorite of the 4. Guy gets in a car accident, kills his wife. He doesn't kill his wife, the car accident kills him. Yeah, whatever, fucking. Okay. Car accident kills his wife, gives him amnesia, okay? Has an experimental medical procedure done where he goes into his memories physically and tries to unlock them by brute force, and there are some scary monsters in his brain. It's kind of like Memento meets Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, but a mediocre horror movie. And it's pretty okay. I thought it was fine. There's a twist at the end that I kind of like. It has, like, an idea behind it. So I'm gonna get Black Box is a 6 out of 10. That one was fun. The Lie. This movie is called The Lie. The Lie is the most insane movie of the year. And if this movie had come out in theaters under normal circumstances, we would all be having a fucking field day with it. A teen girl murders her best friend for absolutely no reason, right? And then her divorced parents fall in love again, working together to help her cover up the murder, okay? It's like the Parent Trap, except instead of just switching places with your sibling, you kill an innocent adolescent girl. I'm telling you, there's a twist at the end that is the most insane thing I've ever seen in a movie in my life. It's required viewing. Oh, 2 out of 10, but like a really good 2 out of 10. Books of Blood was an anthology movie made up of 3 half-hour short films with some other little stuff sort of interstitially woven in. First one, girl stays at an Airbnb. Turns out they're murderers. Pretty fine. Second one. This is the best one. The second one is this weird guy who cons this scientist into believing in ghosts and spirits and stuff. But then it turns out that they're actually real, unbeknownst to the con man, and the scientist gets the spirits to fuck his shit up. It's pretty good. And the third one is just like tying together a whole bunch of threads so that actually it's one story instead of just 3 separate ones like they said it was gonna be. And I don't care for that shit at all. Just let it be 3. I don't like it that. At all. I don't know. One of them was good, the other two were lame, it all kind of cancels each other out. I give it a 5 out of 10. Nocturne, another Welcome to the Blumhouse. This is 2 twin sisters, both going to a prestigious music... Nocturne is the 3rd Welcome to the Blumhouse picture, and it's about 2 twin sisters who both go to a prestigious music academy, and they're constantly in competition over who's the better pianist. But one of them stumbles upon some black magics, and hilarity ensues. This one's pretty okay, too. It looks really nice, and the performances are all really good, and it's kind of creepy. There's some fun black magic stuff in it. So I'll give that one a 6 out of 10, too. Nocturne, pretty okay. Might want to check it out. And the final Welcome to the Blumhouse is called Evil Eye. This one is an adaptation of an Audible original audio drama about an Indian woman struggling, you know, fighting the familial pressures. Your mom's always telling her, you gotta get married, why don't you have a man? And then she finally finds a fiance, and it turns out that fiance is her mom's abuser from 30 years ago who died and is now being reincarnated into a new guy to come and abuse her. So, like, I don't really know either. It was fine. 5 out of 10. Also, not really a horror movie. Not really a horror movie by any criteria. A Babysitter's Guide to Monster Hunting. This one's about a babysitter's guide to monster hunting. This one's a big, bright, silly kids movie where it turns out there's like this ancient sect of babysitters who've sworn an oath to defend the world from these CGI goblins, and they've all got, like, colorful hair and clothes and stuff. Very Robert Rodriguez, very Spy Kids. Reminds me of the Santa Claus in a weird kind of way. And it was totally fine. I mean, it's not for adults, but if you're a kid and you got an hour and a half and your parents want to go get some chores done, sure. Be a babysitter's guide to monster hunting for a few minutes. Why not? And Tom Felton is in it. This feels like the only thing I've seen Tom Felton do since Rise of the Planet of the Apes. And he's good in it. I wish he was around more. I don't know what's up with him. Bad Hair. Bad Hair is about some bad hair. This is definitely my favorite horror movie this month. It's a satirical horror movie about the way we treat black women's hair in society. Trying to fit in at her corporate office, the protagonist gets a straight weave from a creepy barbershop, and the hair turns out to be some kind of ancient monster that just kills everybody around her. It's pretty good. It's shot on like ultra grainy 16mm, and it's got all these super wide angle close-ups, so it like really looks and feels like a Spike Lee movie from 1982. It's pretty good. I was really into it. I give that one a 7 out of 10. Bad Hair, probably the best of the Halloween antics this year. And the last horror movie is called His House on Netflix. This is a BBC-produced horror movie about a married couple of African immigrants who are moving into a new government-assigned house in England. And holy shit, there are all these sequences that are like just the two of them encountering ghosts and monsters in this old shitty house that are so scary. This is easily the scariest horror movie I've seen all year. I was so surprised at how genuinely effective it is at just scaring the shit out of you. But it's also kind of boring at any of the times when it's not actively scaring the shit out of you. And it, you know, it's a weird criticism to say about a movie about the experience of African refugees, but it's also just a pretty, it's a bummer of a movie. It's not like fun to watch, it's like super dour. And when it's October 30th and I'm looking for a spooky good time, it's just not exactly my cup of tea in that instance. Cup of tea because it's an English movie. Thank you. Matt Smith was in it. He was pretty good. Give that one a 7 out of 10 also. Okay. Those are the horror movies. Let's just stop. Let's slow it down. Let's take a breath. Everybody take a deep breath with me. In through your nose. Out through your mouth. Okay. Everybody. The 4-year-old version is so good, you guys. The 40-year-old version is an autobiographical movie directed by and starring Rada Blank. It's a dramedy about a 39-year-old theater teacher who's on the cusp of either doubling down on trying to become a successful playwright or abandoning theater completely to pursue music instead. It's a very heartfelt movie that has a lot to say about what black artists are expected to create and how they can often be restricted, need to conform to white expectations. But it's also hilariously funny, without interfering with the real emotion at the heart of the movie at all. Her high school students are impeccably written, and all of these kids are so good. Like, every single one of them knocks it out of the park.
Nah, we should do some racial type political shit, where a black man fucks this white girl and dies.
And that's political because...
40-year-old version is absolutely everything that you want a black and white Sundance indie dramedy to be, without any of the bullshit that they usually are. This is the funniest movie of the month, hands down, maybe even of the year. And this line right here is the new high watermark for how much a movie in this series has made me laugh.
What? A skinny white dude with the fattest ass. Yo, he was standing with his Becky. When her eyes met mine, she looked away like she was Shane G. They must have had a real love. Or that bitch had a fetish for some black girl butt. But a butt painted white. Connected to this pink ding-a-ling. It made me sing. White man with a black woman's butt. How you carry all that back there? What the fuck?
Yes, what the fuck?
8 out of 10. Highly recommended. Charm City Kings is a coming-of-age story about three black boys from Baltimore who are obsessed with the local culture around motocross bikes. And, you know, I hate to be flip about it, but it's honestly nothing you've never seen before. The family is impoverished, there's substantial pressure to get into crime to support their family in an over-policed urban area. And you know there's a part where the mom finds the money he's making from crime under the bed and she says, "Where did you get this money? Where did it come from?" And, you know, maybe I'd be more receptive to this if it wasn't an immediate chaser to 40-year-old version, which makes a lot of really salient points about African Americans having to write poverty porn in order to get stories told. And this movie kind of feels exactly like what Rada Blank is trying to avoid in her work. But nevertheless, I really like a lot of the hyper-regional specificity and with all the motocross stuff. There's this chase scene at the beginning that rules. There's also, you know, a big brother mentor cop character that I think is portrayed in a really different way than what you're used to seeing, and I think is really intelligently written. And along that line, I think the ending of this movie is really, really creative. So all in all, I liked it. I'll give it a 7 out of 10. Okay, so I know Trial of the Chicago 7 was kind of a hot-button movie for a second there, and a lot of people have a lot of things to say about it, but I gotta put my foot down and say that I fucking love this movie, and I'm not at all sorry about it. The discourse around Aaron Sorkin right now is all about sort of pointing out his mannerisms and his repeated techniques, and,
you know, sometimes that's hilarious. There's a supercut that Kevin T. Porter made on YouTube of Sorkinisms, quote-unquote, that is hilarious. But there's also a lot of people between Trial of the Chicago 7 and The West Wing sort of picking apart what the political ideology of his work is. I guess all I'm trying to say is that Sorkin kind of only does one thing, whether it's artistically or politically. He's sort of just become very good at one particular kind of writing, and a lot of people are just exhausted by it. They feel very over-familiar with Sorkin, if that makes sense. But not me, hey-yo! Trial of the Chicago 7 is... it's almost obnoxiously timely. It's about a group of unrelated leftist individuals and groups being put on trial as one unit for inciting riots and violence in Chicago in 1968, protesting the Vietnam War. It asks a lot of questions without easy answers, and it tells a real-life story that I think we could all benefit from knowing at least some version of. And it does all of it at a million miles an hour in the snappiest, Sorkiniest way possible, and I love that shit. Not even to mention performances from Sacha Baron Cohen, Jeremy Strong, Eddie Redmayne, Frank Langella, Mark Rylance, Yahya Abdul-Mateen. Holy shit, Yahya Abdul-Mateen is so good in this movie. Michael Keaton shows up? I love it when that happens. I don't know, I'm just excited about it. And I've seen a lot of people say that they don't like this movie for a lot of different reasons. You know, political reasons and just aesthetic reasons. And they're all valid. You know, they make salient points. It's valid criticism. But I'm not embarrassed about the fact that I loved it. I'm just a big Sorkhead, what can I say? And hey, I'll just add, maybe if you couldn't handle a stressful political thriller pre-election, maybe it'll go down a little bit smoother post-election. Molly's Game is really good. Aaron Sorkin's other movie he directed, Molly's Game, pretty good. Just wanted to put that out there because people don't give that movie enough credit, because that movie rules too. Anyway, 9 out of 10. The first 9 out of 10 in this series. I love this movie. Clouds is another Justin Baldoni movie about folks with terminal illnesses. This movie is about a high school senior who learns he only has months to live. And if I'm being completely honest with you guys, I did kind of shirk my journalistic responsibility a little bit on this one. I didn't finish it. I've never been a big fan of tearjerkers, and when I felt my tears being jerked on my third streaming movie of the day that day, I didn't have the energy to follow through with it. For what it's worth, it's effective. It successfully jerked my tears, okay? It went down very smooth, and it was fun to watch, despite the fact that it was sort of engineered to play with your heartstrings. And I like Sabrina Carpenter, too. She's sort of pigeonholed into these teen romance movies, but she's always good in them, and I hope she can break out eventually. Anyway, I'll abstain from a rating since I didn't finish yet. I hope you guys can forgive me, but like, all in all, if you're into this sort of thing, it seems like, you know, a pretty good example of a terminal illness movie. Rebecca, it's boring. This one's is boring. It's a new adaptation of the novel famously first adapted by Alfred Hitchcock, and it's boring. It's a boring movie, 3 out of 10. I'm sorry to be so mean about it, but I watched a lot of movies and I'm running out of patience for boring ones. Witches is a Robert Zemeckis movie that premiered on HBO Max, which is insane. That said, it's not very good. Zemeckis has had a really hard time putting out bangers since the turn of the century, besides like maybe Allied, which I like. And Witches isn't exactly a return to form. The most notable thing about it really is just the way that the witches look. And Anne Hathaway is obviously having an absolute ball in this performance, but really she only gets to go as big as you want her to be for a pretty small slice of the movie. And the movie around it is mostly bland. It doesn't have the ambition or the effort that made Zemeckis' prime work great, with the exception of one shot, this shot.
So it looked like a big test might be coming.
Look at that! That's Zemeckis all over. ring ring, hey, the 90s called, and they say, you should do more stuff like that, Robert Zemeckis, like that one shot. And the rest of the movie just isn't interesting. It's not especially good looking, by which I mean both the cinematography and the CGI are very lackluster. The performances, aside from Anne Hathaway, are fine. And the scope of it is just not as ambitious as I want from a Zemeckis flick. But it's short, and it's, I wouldn't say it's boring. And Tucci's good. You gotta love Tucci. Just for you, Stanley, Tucci, I'll give it a 6 out of 10. Wah-wah-wee-wah, my wife. I don't know if I'll put that in anywhere, but I guess I just wanted to have that just in case I wanted to put that in there somewhere. Okay, so where do we start with this one? Borat : subsequent movie film was a surprise release with less than a month notice, 15 years after the original Borat movie debuted. In the early 2000s, Sacha Baron Cohen was a pioneer of comedy that was somehow also journalism. And Borat was his magnum opus. In character as a caricature of a Eurasian journalist named Borat, he spoke to real Americans in a candid setting and exposed and highlighted the cultivated xenophobia and general awfulness of the average American in the Bush administration. But what does Borat really have to say in the Trump era? The trickiest thing about this movie is that Americans recognize Borat almost universally in 2020. And Cohen deals with this in two ways. First of all, he adds an odd layer of fiction and deceit by dressing Borat up in disguise, making mini segments take place with real Americans speaking to Sacha Baron Cohen in character as Borat, in character as someone else, which is not ideal. But the second thing he does is he shifts part of the responsibility of the movie to a co-star, Maria Bakalova, playing Borat's daughter. And holy shit, she is so good in this. Maria Bakalova is only 22, and she's going toe-to-toe with Sacha Baron Cohen in the highest pressure filming scenario possible. I cannot believe how funny she is and how much she kills this role. But overall, my real take on this is that nothing is ever quite as impressive the second time you do it. Borat 2 is funny and sometimes scathing, but ultimately it's a trick we've seen before. I really like Stephen Thompson's take in the Pop Culture Happy Hour podcast that in 2005, Borat felt like it was exposing something. Something that most people were genuinely unaware of, if not willfully ignoring. In 2020, we all kinda know. That silent underbelly of conservative middle America has gotten louder and louder every year since Borat 1 came out, so in 2020, doing Borat again just feels like it's pointing out the obvious. But anyway, it's still very funny, and it's given me lots to think about in the last few weeks, so I'll give it a 7 out of 10. I'm glad it exists, it's fun. Over the Moon is Netflix's shot at a big-budget animated blockbuster in a year without any. Over the Moon tells the story of the Chinese daughter of a widower father. The father's also Chinese. I don't know why I phrased it like that. Who has a hard time accepting her father's new fiancé. Inspired by the myth of the moon goddess Chang'e, who seeks her dead husband forever through the sky, she builds a rocket to the moon to go and meet her. This movie mostly works, but it's so deeply indebted to the Disney formula, it almost feels kind of pathetic. You know, it's a 3D animated musical about a young girl from a particular culture who, along with her funny animal best friend, embarks on an adventure as a commentary on some kind of grief or loss. You know, do you see what I'm saying? This movie also represents a sort of hyperinflation of comic relief characters. Not only are there two different funny, spastic companions over the course of the movie, but every single character, including the two silly companions, has their own discreet, funny animal friend. It's out of control. It's like a Russian nesting doll of comic relief. But the songs are fine. I'm a little bit annoyed by every musical needing to have at least one Lin-Manuel Miranda rap song in it now, but, you know, whatever, c'est la vie. It looks great. It's got a lot of fascinating ways of blending 2D and 3D animation, but honestly, it's just not anything you haven't seen before. If you've got a Disney Plus subscription, there are at least like 10 or 15 movies that do everything that this movie does, but like 15% better. Watch Coco, watch Moana, you know, like all these, it's all the same stuff, and those ones are way better. When I heard that there was a new Sofia Coppola movie coming out, where Bill Murray plays Rashida Jones' dad, I just assumed it would be my number one movie of the year. Lost in Translation is one of my old favorites, and another Coppola-Murray joint with a delightfully vague and capricious title like On the Rocks seemed like, hey Jackson, this one's for you. And it was exactly what I hoped for about an hour. Rashida Jones thinks her husband is cheating on her, and she asks her dad for advice. This part of the movie is just entirely Rashida Jones and Bill Murray driving around New York, having dinner, just chatting, having conversations about their opposing views on the nature of relationships and monogamy, men and women, sexuality, all that kind of stuff. It rules. And it makes you think. It's like it's stimulating without being too challenging. It gives you a set of issues to just kind of pleasantly chew on for the rest of the day. And then in the third act, they start doing too much stuff, and it lost me a little bit. There were too many events in the last half hour. Fewer events, please. I just wanted to hang out with Rashida Jones and Bill Murray, you know? I wouldn't say I was disappointed per se, but it just didn't quite live up to my expectations, but regardless, I liked it a lot. I'll go 8 out of 10.
Just love these pajamas.
I'm just gonna read you this official synopsis for Holidate, okay? Fed up with being single on holidays, two strangers agree to be each other's platonic plus ones all year long, only to catch real feelings along the way. And like, don't you just wanna shoot yourself in the face? I don't know, I'm being mean. Because honestly, Holidate wasn't as painful as I was expecting it to be. In a lot of ways, it is absolutely the trite, lazy rom-com you would expect, but it being an R-rated comedy actually differentiates it enough from the mean that it's at least slightly interesting. And both of the leads are actually really good, and it's directorially pretty interesting. I think it's well directed. But I don't know, what can I say? It's not much. It's just not a lot of movie, you know? The guy's name is Jackson. So that's kind of fun. That was fun for me. I don't know, that's all I got. It's exactly what you thought it would be. Except that they speak very frankly and graphically about sex, which is kind of fun and interesting in a rom-com like this. So, 5 out of 10. I'll go 5 out of 10 for Holidate.
So October had the most movies of any month that I've covered since I started this project. And the more volume that I introduce into this study, the more I find that the numbers don't really change. October's movies averaged 5.58, and the new total average for the whole study, I'm calling it a study now to make it seem more interesting, and the new total average for the entire study is 5.47, which is like basically exactly the same as the first average I took way back in August. So like, I don't know, it seems pretty consistent that every month there's gonna be a couple of bangers and a couple of turds, and just like a whole bunch of stuff that's squarely in the middle, that's fine. It's just perfectly all right. But that said, there is something very interesting happening in terms of who is making these streaming movies. October feels like this weird tipping point where all of a sudden, between August and now, we've tipped over into this world where these streaming movies are coming from, like, big-name Hollywood auteur directors. I already mentioned Robert Zemeckis and Sofia Coppola coming out with movies this month, but in November, we've got even more, including the likes of Ron Howard and Chris Columbus, and December has got the Russo brothers, David Fincher, and Robert Rodriguez directing direct-to-streaming movies. And I can only assume that these movies are going to get more and more creatively stacked the deeper into this pandemic we get. But, conversely, we got some good vaccine news this week. It's not out of the question to think that we could all be back in theaters seeing movies again within 3 or 4 months. When that happens, is this creative bubble gonna burst? Are all these directors gonna abandon ship and go right back to the theatrical releases the way they always have? Or is there gonna be enough goodwill built up with these companies that people are gonna keep coming back to them, even after the theaters open back up again? David Fincher just signed a 4-year exclusive deal with Netflix for an undisclosed number of movies. There's gonna be multiple David Fincher movies going straight to Netflix over the next few years. And that is so insane, I can't help but feel like some other people might try to follow suit. Who could that be? I don't know. Seems like the only people who haven't done streaming exclusive movies right now are Spielberg and Tarantino. Pretty much everyone else has fallen right in line and gotten one out just straight into your living room. But I just don't know, and I'm excited to see. I truly am. And, like, I'm gonna be real with you guys today. Like, just this once, I'm gonna be real with you, okay? October almost broke me. It was too many movies for me to be responsible for. And even though I at one point had to sit down and watch 4 Blumhouse horror movies in one sitting, which is a fate worse than death, I still can't help but be excited about this project. Because we are at such an insane inflection point in the film industry. And I feel like I've got my fingers squarely on the pulse of exactly the most interesting moment of it. I feel like these streaming movies, what they are, how they do, how they're received, are going to dictate exactly what happens with Hollywood for the next decade. And I feel like sitting down and watching all of these movies, no matter if they're shitty, because a lot of the time they are, but regardless, there's something that feels important about these movies at this moment, and I can't help but be excited whenever I think about them, and thinking about, like, trying to figure out what it means, and how we're going to adjust moving forward, and what the film industry is going to look like in a year, 2 years, 10 years. But I don't know. I got catching up to do. It means I gotta watch, like, 8 movies in the next week. And I... Whatever, I gotta keep it together because I still got 9 months to go, and one of them is gonna be December, which is gonna be insane. So, that's all, thank you. Thank you for listening. I'm sure that this video is 9 hours long, and I really appreciate you sticking around to the end of it. And go ahead and subscribe to the channel if you would like to, and listen to my podcast. We stream every Friday night on this channel. The podcast is called No Nerds Allowed. It's cool and fun. It's me and my sister and my friend. We just talk about a movie. Not a big deal. Sun's getting more in my eyes the longer we film. That's all. Thank you. And I hope you all are well. I guess that's that. Okay, cool. I think we can call it there.